The two become one. And love is a beautiful thing. Love is the thing that lays down its life for the other. And at the end of the day, that laying down of the life brings a supernatural empowering of God in your marriage. Because when you lay down your life, His resurrection power comes into your marriage. And you have what is called the spirit of marriage. Because God comes in that three-legged stool and says, I can bless this. And you want the blessing of God more than anything. Thus we see that this day is crowned with honor and sacredness by God Himself. Although this might be a government's idea, although this might be to help in good families and good order, this is a sacred occasion crowned by God Himself. God is here. God is in this. It's not just a license. God is in marriage. This is His idea. And so this is a time of the blessing, the holiness. It's a holy occasion. And the sacredness of God. We've diminished it, but at the end of the day, God wants to crown it with sacredness. Amen? Into this beauty and holy relationship, Kelsey Ray Kelly. I like that name. Kelsey Ray. That's a cool name. And Christopher Scott Eggleston desired to be united because God meant that it should bring fulfillment and happiness to their lives. Let's right now invoke His blessing as they pledge themselves together and make their vows before God and man. And before these witnesses, can we bow our heads together? Oh God, we pray your blessing upon this ceremony, upon this service. Lord, we know that the world has been thrown into this disarray because of this virus, but God, you are here. You're not somewhere else, you are here. And so God, we pray for your honor, your sacredness, your blessing upon this day. And Lord, we know that they are making these vows today before God and man, because more than anything, they want God's blessing upon their marriage. And Lord, what else is there? If we try to do it ourselves, it will come to nothing. But with God's blessing, then our marriage can be full of life and full of fruitfulness. So Lord, we come and we pray your blessing upon this day and upon this ceremony, upon this couple, and upon this marriage. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Who gives this woman to be married to this man? You. Give. Bring her over. That's it right there. Hallelujah, the two of you. The union that you're about to enter in is the closest and tenderest of all human relationships. Listen to this. To Christians, it is a bond in the Lord. Chris, the highest ideal you can have before you is given in God's word. Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself up for it, that he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water by the word, that he might present it to himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that it should be holy and without blemish. So, scripture tells us, so ought men to love their wives as their own bodies. For he that loves his wife loves himself, for no man ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes and cherishes it, even as the Lord the church. Husbands, it says, dwell with your wives according to knowledge, giving honor unto the wife as unto the weaker vessel, and as being heirs together of the grace of life. Now listen to this verse, Chris. That your prayers may not be hindered. How you love your life, how you love your wife is very important. And scripture commends us as men, if we want our prayers to be heard, love your wife. The word love there, of course, is the word agape. It means to lay your life down. And as you lay your life down, then God comes in and breathes life upon your marriage. And God, if you are hard in your heart, then God cannot hear your prayers. And we want God to hear our prayers for our marriage, for our children that will come. We need the help of God. And so as we honor our wife, as we nourish her, as we cherish her, as we give honor to her, then God comes along, hears our prayer, and begins to work in our marriage far beyond any book that you can read. Read books, God bless them. But at the end of the day, we need God to help us with our marriage. Hallelujah. Kelsey, the Bible indicates that we are to prefer one another in love. I would hope that it would never come to positional leadership in a marriage compared to relational leadership. We are called to prefer one another in love, not to hierarchical dominance. I believe a dominating form of leadership in a marriage, in either husband or wife, is not what God has desired, because that's not what God asks of us. God never wanted us to serve him only out of fear of position. He says in John 15:15, in the Passion Translation, I have never called you servants or slave, because a master doesn't confide in his servants, and servants don't always understand what the master is doing. But I call you my most intimate friends, for I reveal to you everything that I've heard from my Father. I love the fact that in our marriage, my wife and I make decisions together. Now, there are times in our marriage where a decision has to be made, and she looks at me and says, okay, it's on you, buddy. You know, but we work together. There isn't a, you know, I always say to a couple, if they come to me about their marriage and they start quoting, well, the husband is the head of the wife, I always say to myself, it's already over. I mean, if he has to pull out that card, something's not right. Because I know with my wife, we work together, we make decisions, we prefer one another in love. At the end of the day, which in all our years of marriage, I can't think of really one decision where there was one. But even then, I was probably wrong. Only one decision where she said, I want you to make it. We work together. I honor her because I want my prayers to be heard. Hallelujah. I remind you both of the biblical description of love. Our generation has no idea of really what love is. It's moved beyond the understanding of the biblical explanation of love. Love is slow to lose patience. It looks for a way of being constructive. It is not possessive. It is neither anxious to impress, nor does it cherish inflated ideas of its importance. Love is forbearing and kind. Let me tell you something. Let kindness dominate your relationship, dominate your conversation. Love knows no jealousy. Love does not boast. It is not conceited. It is not unmannerly, selfish, irritable, or mindful of wrongs. Let me tell you right now, forgive, move on. The Bible says, don't let the sun go down on your wrath, lest you give the enemy a foothold. Don't give the enemy a foothold. Work through things, forgive, and move on. It does not rejoice in injustice, but joyfully sides with the truth. It can overlook faults. Hallelujah. It can overlook faults. I had a couple in my church who came to me. She was mad at her husband. They'd been married 8 years because he didn't hang up the towel in the bathroom every morning. Every morning, she would hang up the towel and call him everything but blessed. I thought to myself, you need to get over it. He's not going to hang up that towel. And if that's the biggest issue you have, you need to be thanking Jesus every day. There will be faults. There will be things. Hallelujah. Let the towel go. You can do it. It is full of trust, love, full of hope, full of endurance. Love never fails. A union of such ideals is to be entered into thoughtfully, advisedly, discreetly, reverently, and in the fear of God. I, a minister of the gospel, charge you both as you stand in the presence of God, and as you now make your pledge and vows to each other, to remember that love, faith, and loyalty alone will avail as the foundation of a happy home. If these solemn vows be kept without violation, if you steadfastly endeavor to do the will of your Heavenly Father, keep God in your marriage. Keep God in your marriage. Do His will. If you do His will, I'm telling you, if you honor God, everything else will come into line. Hallelujah. Your lives will be full of joy if you do this, and the home you're establishing will abide in peace. I'm done except for one statement that I make to every other couple I do their wedding. Your marriage will be what you make it. If you want strife, you'll have strife. If you want to fight, you'll fight. If you want to be angry, you can be angry. If you want to be bitter, you can be bitter. But don't blame the devil, and don't blame anyone, and don't blame your spouse. Look inside and say, God, help me to change. Help me to forgive. Your marriage will be what you make it. I heard the story one time of the angel of the Lord sitting outside of the church, and the enemy, the devil, was sitting outside the church crying. And the angel of the Lord walks by the devil and says to the devil, what are you crying about? And the devil says, those people are blaming me for things that I never even did. Your marriage will be what you make it. Love, forgive, be gracious, be kind,
forgive, pick up the towel, don't worry about it. Love one another.
Amen? Hallelujah. This time, the parents, the four parents, one at a time, are going to come share their hearts to you. Parents, one at a time, feel free. Don't all rush.
Chris and Kelsey, stand on the other side. We all know that the plans that you made for your wedding didn't work out the way you thought that they should work out. A lot of things in our lives happen that way.
Yeah.
A lot of things. And however, no matter how it looks, as you're standing here in this awesome attire, I love it. God knew. God was in control. And actually, this is the day that we want to bring you two together. And I just feel that in my heart. That, in this very intimate gathering of your parents, your loved ones, and everyone on Zoom and Facebook, you two were brought into this world by God's timing. Both of you were. Through your parents, through us, you have blessed us. Christopher, you're a near impossible child, and I believe you were a near impossible child as well. You know, but everything is possible with God. And God brought families together because of you, Chris, and because of you, Kelsey. You brought families together. Christopher, you brought so much joy in my life and your father's life. And I know if your sisters and brothers were here, they would say the same thing because, you know, when Kurt and I got married, we brought two families together, but the deal was sealed with you because there was just so much love and so much joy having you in our family. There was never a dull moment with you, Chris. you're the last grandchild born to my mother and father and to Grace Ann. Grace Ann Eggleston, your grandmother. Ray and Pat Nagel and Frank Young. And as you start your life, your new life together, remember where you came from, both of you. Remember your childhood. Remember your heart's desires, your heart's aches. And most importantly, remember your God, because he's been with you every moment of your life from the beginning. And he will never leave you. He has promised us that. He will never leave you or forsake you. Share your experiences with your children. If you choose to have children, God blesses you with that. So that they will know who he is, who God is, because he's the most important thing in your life. So as your pastor has said, there's two of you, but there's three, because you're joined together by God, and he is the center of your life. He's the rock of your life. And I'm blessed, and I know Kurt is blessed, and our family, to have the two of you joined together. And just remember where you came from, and remember God. Keep him in the subject. Amen.
Well, as you can see the way you're dressed, a lot of your experience came through scouting. And it was 14 years before you were ever allowed to do anything on your own. I remember using that at a scout meeting. And I also didn't have to talk at a scout meeting for the first 10 years. So for you to spring on me that I have to say anything, it's remarkable that I do say anything at all. But a lot of things are impossible. Your original plans were to come to school right from high school. Had you done that, come to Elam right from high school, had you done that, you wouldn't have met Kelsey. A lot of things just have fallen into place.
Amen.
You know, like, a lot of things are just impossible to actually happen, but they did happen. And as Kelsey knows, I'm a great speaker, and I'm going to get out of this as quickly as possible. I just thank you for putting up with him, as my wife puts up with me. Christopher is not always a quiet individual, and as Marty had said, definitely brought excitement into our life. I hope he does the same for you. And the third person in this joining together is the most important part of your marriage. And I believe both of you are going to continue to grow and experience great things. Love you.
Blessed.
Amen.
Thank you.
But I was telling Kelsey yesterday, when she was kind of a little sad about not having the wedding that she dreamed of, and the dress and the suit and all the people here and all the pomp and circumstance that goes with it. And I said, be grateful for what you have, not for what you don't, not ungrateful for what you don't have. Be happy that you're getting married today to a wonderful man that I wholeheartedly approve of. I really do. And I'm just happy that you have what you have here today. It's not exactly what you wanted, but you are truly blessed. And I hope that you will continue to look at the blessing you have and not look at what you don't have. Chris, I couldn't have asked for a better man for my daughter. She is very blessed to have you. And you've been a blessing in our life. Very much a surprise, not having been expected in my life. You know, having the four children, and then I thought that was it. But you came along and you were a blessing to your older sister and your brothers, and I know that they're very happy for you right now and wish they could be here. But they're watching. And enjoying this time with you. And I love you very much. And I always hope for the best for you and pray that God will bless you with your heart's desire, and that both of you will keep God at the center of your life.
Well, I don't know what to say, believe it or not. I look at you, Kelsey, and I've said to you before that to us, to Mom and I, we received a blessing from heaven when you were born. And there was a song back in the 70s. It says, heaven must be missing an angel because she's here with me right now. I believe that. You were an angel. You were such a blessing. Although I did wonder and was a little concerned about you when you were hanging the dog with the rope, you know, and you know, if you used the dog would be at the bottom of the steps, and Kelsey would had a lasso, you know, rope, and would lower it down, and just hook the dog with it, you know, when the dog would be there hanging, you know, and I hope she doesn't treat her husband that way. You know? And And then before she could even talk, before she could even speak, we were in the car one day, and Bethany and I, and Kelsey, a little baby in the back seat, and I sneezed. And I said, "Achoo!" And all of a sudden, I heard out of this little child, "Achoo!" And I looked at Bethany and I said, Did she just copy me? And so I said, "Someone, Achoo!" Sure enough, she said, "Back again." "Achoo!" And Kelsey used to always tease me, always giving me a hard time. And I used to love every minute of it. "Hey, you're a blessing, sweetheart. And you know what? You're going to be a blessed wife. You're going to be a blessing mother. You're going to be a blessing to all those who know. Brought so much joy into our lives, so much." And I just think that through the most difficult times of my life, I would think of the joyful things that God has given me. And you were one of the first things I thought of. And I said, "Lord, you're worthy. You're worthy of my hope. You're worthy of my love. You're worthy of my problems, and you're worthy of my joy." And I tell you both, he is worthy. He is worthy to give all praise and honor and needs to him. And Chris, I always said, no one could love my daughter as much as I did. It's a father thing. No guy could ever love my daughter as much as I did until I met you. Yeah. But when I met you, I said, "There's somebody who loves my daughter as much as I do." You've been an awesome guy. You've been wonderful. When they asked about marrying Kelsey, and there was like no reservation. There was no hesitation for saying yes. I felt like she was going to be in the best hands because she has a man who has a great heart. And as a father, that means a lot to me. So I bless you. I give you my blessing, both of you. I believe that there's a heavenly call from a father that says, "Heavenly Father, bless this couple, bless our children. For you, O Lord, are worthy that we call upon you, Lord, and call your blessings down." And I ask you to bless Chris. I ask you to bless Kelsey. I ask you to fill their hearts with love and joy and hope. And Lord, and as they begin their journey together today, Lord, that they walk in threesome, that they walk with you, Lord, and that you, Lord, would show your face to them every day of their lives. I thank you.
Say one thing, to have a blessing like that of both sets of parents.
That's right.
You have no idea, as a pastor, what I've seen, that both parents blessing you like that is such a foundation, and there's something in God that adds to your marriage when you have the parents behind you like this. It's a beautiful thing. Amen? In-laws that don't become outlaws are beautiful things. Amen. At this time, we're going to have the vows. Will you, Christopher Scott Eggleston, take Kelsey Ray Kelly to be your wedded wife, to live together according to God's holy ordinance? Will you love and comfort her, honor and keep her, in joy and in sorrow, in sickness and in health, forsaking all others until God by death shall separate you, or until the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ? If so, answer by saying, I will.
I will.
That's clear. I heard that. Will you, Kelsey Ray Kelly, take Christopher Scott Eggleston to be your wedded husband, to live together according to God's holy ordinance? Will you love and comfort him, honor and keep him, in joy and in sorrow, in sickness and in health, forsaking all others until God by death shall separate you, or until the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ? If so, answer by saying, I will. Amen. At this time, I want you to repeat. I'll help you through this. These vows, if you can repeat them after it, we'll start with you, Christopher. I, Christopher, take you, Kelsey.
I, Christopher, take you, Kelsey.
To be my wedded wife.
To be my wedded wife.
To love you with all my heart's affection.
To love you with all my heart's affection.
To endow you with all my earthly possessions. To endow you. When we got married, there weren't many. To endow you with all my earthly possessions.
To endow you with all my earthly possessions.
To give you the honor of my name.
To give you the honor of my name.
And to share with you the grace of my God.
And to share with you the grace of my God.
To have and to hold.
To have and to hold.
From this day forward.
From this day forward.
For better, for worse.
For better, for worse.
For richer, for poorer.
For richer, for poorer.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
To comfort and to cherish you.
To comfort and to cherish you.
To honor and to keep you.
To honor and to keep you.
In joy and in sorrow.
In joy and in sorrow.
And to preserve with you.
And to preserve with you.
This bond holy and unbroken.
This bond holy and unbroken.
Until the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Until the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Or until God by death shall separate us.
Or until God by death separates us.
And thereto I give you my pledge.
And thereto I give you my pledge.
Amen. Kelsey, if you can repeat after me. I, Kelsey, take you, Christopher.
I, Kelsey, take you, Christopher.
To be my wedded husband.
To be my wedded husband.
To have and to hold.
To have and to hold.
From this day forward.
From this day forward.
For better, for worse.
For better, for worse.
For richer, for poorer.
For richer, for poorer.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
To love, comfort, and respect you.
To love, comfort, and respect you.
Honor and keep you.
In joy and in sorrow.
In joy and in sorrow. And to preserve with you. And to preserve with you. This bond.
This bond.
Holy and unbroken.
Holy and unbroken.
Until the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Until the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Or until death shall separate us.
Or until death shall separate us.
And thereto I give you my pledge.
Thereto I give you my pledge.
Where you go, I will go.
Where you lodge, I will lodge.
Your people shall be my people.
Your people shall be my people.
And your God, my God.
Your God, my God.
Amen. Christopher, what token do you give that you will faithfully fulfill these vows? A ring. The golden circlet. Time immemorial has been a symbol of wedded love. It is made of pure gold to symbolize pure love. It is one unbroken circle to symbolize unending love. Whenever you shall see it, and my wife makes me wear mine, it will remind you of this holy moment when your lives and hearts were united as one. Kelsey, what token do you give in acknowledgement of your vows? There it is, all tied. Emblems of purity and endless devotion, showing how lasting and perishable is the faith now pledged mutually between you. You do the other each other wed, and these vows forever seal. For as much as Kelsey Ray Kelly and Christopher Scott Eggleston have covenanted together in holy wedlock before God, and in the presence of these witnesses have pledged their love to each other, and have declared the same by giving and receiving of rings and by joining hands, I, by the authority committed to me by the church and the state of New York, pronounce that they are husband and wife together in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Those whom God has joined together, let no one ever divide or put asunder. We bless them now in Jesus' name and forever seal these vows. Amen. Amen. At this time, I'm going to ask the family to come up, and the grandparents are here too. We got some grandparents. Hallelujah. I saw them out there praying for you during your vows. We're going to ask them to come up and to pray and lay hands. We've asked Sister Sylvia Evans to come up and just lead this time. She wants to share for a moment. Feel free, Sister Sylvia. But we want you to open this, and then I will close this time out as we lay hands. And as parents, as family, as friends, as we lay hands on this couple and bless them in Jesus' name. Sister Sylvia.
Oh, man. This is something else. I did ask Kelsey last night if there was a dress code. I don't know that I could have taken it in stride here to join this particular. This is cute. All right, let's just allow you to pray your prayer of blessing, any of you. This is as close as we can get, the family blessing. And so let's just allow you to speak to the Lord on their behalf. And then they've asked me to give a word. If the Lord gives it to me, I'm to close in blessing.
Yeah.
Go ahead. Let's take the father of the bride first and the mother. Now let's start with the grandparents. Let's let it come down by generations. Uncle Dan, Aunt Nancy.
Father, we pray that this marriage will be light to many. We should pray, Father, that they will be an example to many.
Yes.
Lord, I pray that you would help them to honor and prefer one another. We ask, Lord, there be a spirit of unity in their home. We pray, Lord, that you'll help them to trust one another.
Yes, God.
And to work together.
Yes.
Because the two are one.
Yes.
Father, we know it takes time. It takes experiences to come to that. But Lord, in the times of being tested and tried, they'll remember their commitment. They'll remember that they're in the process of becoming one.
Yes.
Let your will be not my will, but thine. We commit them to you, Lord. Ask your blessing upon them.
Yes.
Lord, help them to be open. What you want your lives to be.
Yes, God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Lord, any of their plans may it be tentative plans.
Yeah.
Lord, help them to be open for changes that you would bring to their life. Guide them, Lord.
Guide them.
Jesus.
In Jesus' name.
Let's bring Mom right over here. And Uncle Dan, if you step that way, because the camera is trying to capture this. And you want those out there to hear you pray now, okay? It's yours, Granny.
Oh, Lord. We think back over the years, Lord, but I'm sure with both of these, the changes that have come in their lives. And we thank you for the times that you have led them. You have been with them, Lord, and you have destined them, Lord, for this time.
Destined.
Lord, I know that you've destined them for things in the future. And so I pray, Lord, that their minds and their hearts and their thoughts would be on your will for them, Lord, and to lead them into all that you have for them, Lord.
Yes,
Lord. bless them together, I pray, Lord. Bless them. Let their love so abound, Lord, that they overlook things that might irritate or might even hinder what you want to do in their lives. But let them learn, Lord, that you forgave them, and they should forgive each other and just live in harmony with you. Oh, God, we commit them to you, Lord, and thank you for them, Lord, and for this union that you brought them to you. In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Thank you.
Amen. That's a granny prayer. Here comes mommy's prayer.
Bless them.
Lord, thank you so much for this couple. Lord, I thank you that from the time that they were young, you set them aside for your work, just for the call that you had on their life, and that you have chosen to join them together to fulfill that call. And that two of them will be stronger than one in the ministry that you have called them to. Lord, that in times of happiness and in joy, they will call upon you and thank you. That in times of hardship, they will call upon you and thank you. That they have someone to turn to when they need help. Lord, I just ask you to take their lives and use them to the full potential that you have for them. That they would always seek you. To say, what's next? What do you want us to do? What do you have for us next? And that they would be willing and able, and you would provide everything that they need to be able to take the steps needed to fulfill the call that you have placed upon their lives.
Yes.
I thank you, Lord, for them. I ask a blessing on them in Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Lord, I just pray that Lord, that they would complement each other, that in their lives together, that they would bring balance to each other, that where one is weak, the other is strong, and Lord, that they would look out for each other, they would care for each other, they would become one, Lord, in complementing each other with their lives and their talents and their good things, Lord, that you would yoke them closer and bind them closer because they need each other, Lord. Because they are together, they complete what you have brought together, Lord. And that, Lord, you would have them journey together, and Lord, each and every day, Lord, that they would grow stronger and stronger and stronger as one, Lord.
Yes.
We thank you for that. Jesus.
Jesus. Amen.
Father, thank you, Lord, for these two.
Yes.
And thank you for the families that have brought them together. And Lord, I just ask now that they keep their eyes fixed upon you. Keep your eyes fixed upon the Lord. And remember the things that he has brought you through to how you got here today. And keep your eyes fixed upon him and follow the plan that he has laid out before you. He's the one that has brought you together. And I thank you, Lord, for bringing them together. And just always, always remember that he will never leave you nor forsake you. You know, he is the one that you keep your eyes fixed upon. And he's the one that will bring you through. He's the one that brings all of us through. And just remember that. Never forget that. And stay in his word and love each other. And I thank you, Lord, for these two.
Amen.
Jesus.
Heavenly Father, we just parents, grandparents, all of us here, just ask for a special blessing to rain down upon these children of ours, Father. We just ask, Father, that, that they keep their minds open to whatever it is that you have for them, Father. And we just ask that they would just continue to walk in the path following you, and that they would just continue to grow and do everything that you have for them to do, Father. We ask this in our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Amen. The Lord bless them. Amen. At this time, we're going to have a time of worship. And just as a couple, they're both so big.
Oh, my God. What you're doing? It does help. It does help. I thought someone was coming earlier. All right, so let me just say this. If you had a $20,000 wedding today, or a $100,000 wedding, can you believe what some do? You could not have built into that value what you have received right now.
Absolutely.
This is the richest thing that God provides in the scriptures, is the blessing of generations.
That's it.
I don't know about your generation, about you, but...
You know my mother. Crazy things.
Okay. That's who it is. I've been standing here saying, do I know? Because I've known Egglestons for years. The blessing of generations, the right hand of favor, each of these has laid his or her hand upon you. In the scripture, that is rich. It imparts something to you. They're not technically setting you free to go do whatever you want to do. They are imparting to you, and I add it because it's coming down, my grandfather is his father. You understand? So I'm part of this now. This is family. And you have imparted to you, not a command, not a commission, covenant with the Lord, that our seed will inherit promises. Our seed will inherit blessings. And they multiply generation after generation after generation, just like the children have multiplied generation after generation. So it's something that's coming to you by impartation today. Do you receive it? Do you want the blessing of the Lord? I'd like a response. Do you want it? Do you want also the responsibility of receiving those covenants that parents have made, that their children shall serve the Lord? Do you receive that? Would you like to pass that to another generation, or two, or three, or four? Would you?
Yeah.
And I want you to know that with every generation, that intensifies. God loves family blessings. He loves family covenants, and I'm grateful to be part of your covenant that you're doing today. And it's not just an event here. It's a transaction between you and the Holy Spirit, but it's also a transaction here. And you've got these prayers for you that are not just praying for everything that happens today or the next day or the day. They're praying the purpose of God for your whole life, what he wants to accomplish. I just saw the sign up there, tell them I love them. Okay, so even God is telling you he loves you too. And it's his purpose. And so because in all the communications that I had with Kelsey, it was that I had to prophesy. So that's what I was hired to do. No pressure. And so, of course, very seriously, I was seeking the Lord especially today. It's a great responsibility. The clear word that he spoke to me is faithful servants. Faithful servants, and the emphasis was upon faithful. It comes to marriage as well, a faithful man. Who can find? That's quite a question. You have found one from all that I can hear. He's going to be a faithful man for you. And then it's the faithfulness to the Lord. But I was seeing you, Chris, and I don't know you personally, but I was seeing you as a practical servant who could be trusted if a tool was put in your hand, that the tool would be used and returned to its right place. That's very interesting. You don't throw down the tool and walk off the job. You finish the job, you take the tool back, put it into its right place, keep it ready for the next use or for the next person. Very interesting thing that I was seeing. That there is something meticulous about your faithfulness that comes down to detail, responsibility first. The ability to respond to a need, the ability to respond to a request, or even to an order or a commandment, depending under whose authority you are serving. And the ability to respond to that need, sometimes in emergency, there will be situations where you will be the man solving the problem right now because of your ability to respond, because of abilities that God has given you, which includes a clear head in crisis, a clarity to understand the situation and to solve the problem. And I can see that as a physical thing where you have a tool in your hand, but it's not just in the practical. It's in emotional situations, it's in crises that occur around you, that you are the man made for the crisis, and one of the reasons is you have Christ in the crisis. But it's this dependability, so it's the responsibility, because you will take responsibility. You have the ability to respond because you step in, not taking over, not dominating in some bad way, but saying, okay, we need something here. And I'm taking responsibility to find out what it is, and you do it. The two of you serving one another, but then serving together, serving the body of Christ. And then I saw as though you had a whole bunch of little ones running around under your leadership. Now, if they're your own children, that's okay. But it was more the sense of that you will have servant leadership, and then you will have leadership over others who serve. That it would come even to an executive servanthood. And I keep looking at you more, but it's both of you, but it comes into an executive servanthood where you are always serving. It may be that you're the president of the United States or that you're the senior pastor someday, but that you will always be under headship, always serving, always faithful, and then teaching others to serve. And I just saw these people scurrying here and there and taking care of things. I have no idea where you're going to serve. But that's a spirit of grace. Carrying this word, then I was listening, of course, to everything that Pastor Phil was saying. And he gave you the word that Jesus said, I haven't called you servants. I've called you friends. Why? Because a servant doesn't know everything his master is doing. But I've called you into a friendship so that I can tell you everything I know that my Father has told me that I'm to do. It's a high level of servant who comes into friendship. And if you walk in that friendship with the Lord, it's also going to happen between the two of you and in your family, but it's going to happen with the leaders that are over you. where they won't just look at you as a servant. They'll say, they're my friends, they're with me. And I share with them what I'm doing and they understand what I'm doing. So one more blessing, if you can handle one more, can you? I'm gonna bless you as the friends of Jesus and the friends of all of those with whom you serve, wherever it is, and especially friends of one another. So we release the blessing of friendship. The blessing of friendship. First of all, right here, that they will always be friends first. This will be the primary friendship in an earthly, on an earthly level. But I thank you that they will have the gift of friendship in the relationship with you, Lord Jesus, that you will be their friend, they will be your friends. And then we pray for the gift of friendship wherever they serve, whether it's what is a workplace or whether it's the church or wherever it is, that they serve as friends who can be trusted when leaders say to them, this is what we're doing, this is what we need to do, and they are in there together with them as friends, faithful, faithful, faithful. The blessing of the Lord now be upon you, all hands upon them, please, right hands, the right hand of blessing. The Lord bless you. Whatever he blesses, he makes fruitful. He increases, he multiplies. The Lord bless you and keep you, preserve, protect, guard you. The Lord make his face shine upon you. And may his face shine its reflection in your countenances as well. His face shine upon you and be gracious unto you.
Gracious.
Gracious, gracious, gracious. And give you grace that you may give to others. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you.
Hallelujah.
And may your countenance reflect his countenance so that he gives you peace and you bring peace to others. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, we bless you together. Everyone together, we bless you in the name of the Lord. Amen. And amen.
Amen.
Praise God.
Hallelujah. Close out some more.
show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around you.
My joy to present to you Mr. and Mrs. Christopher Eggleston. Christopher, you may kiss your bride.
Oh,
oh, there.